Hallelujah. Unto you is born this day in the city of David. Christ the Lord, the one who shall rule forever and ever, whose kingdom shall never come to an end. Hallelujah. Whose government shall be, the government of the Lord shall be upon his shoulders, and there will be no end to his kingdom. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, listen, I pray that this year you would do more than have a Merry Christmas. I pray that you'd begin to engage with the Holy Ghost and have a happy and glorious Jesus Fest. I mean, could you just imagine that people just get so caught up in the frustration and maybe even just caught up in the captivation over what they're getting and their gifts and their presents and what they want, and at the total, at the expense of completely forgetting about the gift that we're able to give to the Lord of praise and worship. We can come lay down our lives before him as an offering. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That we can begin to take up in even a greater dimension the gifts that he's given to us so that we could be what he's called us to be. And allow the Holy Ghost to have more free course in our lives just simply because we shut more of the stuff that is a distraction and opposing God out of our life. And some of the things that we're going to minister to you this morning are those things that opposes God and opposes his anointing. And they don't just oppose God and oppose his anointing in certain situations that you're unique to the scripture. They oppose God and oppose his anointing in our lives, or attempt to in each one of us individually. We don't realize that many times we just don't realize, we forget that the spirit that is in this world right now, that the God of this world, the prince of the power of the air, that designed everything that people think are just common and ordinary and, oh, there's nothing wrong with it. And, you know, one of Satan's tactics is, don't get upset about that because then you're going to be religious. Don't be overwhelmed or don't be overcome with, you know, doing too much good because then you're going to be religious. And really what it is it's the means by which our defense is removed off of us and we become more influenced by the spirit that stands to oppose everything that belongs to God. There's a spirit that opposes the anointing and everything that belongs to God, and it comes so subtly that we don't even recognize it because it doesn't really have a fear attached to it. It's actually got a pleasure attached to it. You hear me? See, there's a pleasure in this world that is for a season, and because it's got a pleasure and a fun, And you know, ultimately one of the signs of the last days that men will be lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. In other words, they've got a love for God. Oh, I love Jesus. Oh, I love God. Oh, I love going to church. Oh, I love singing. The problem is they become lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. And so at the point in time where the Lord is now working with our lives and working with their hearts to say, no. You got to shut those things out. Those aren't good for you. Those things are going to keep you from my life and from my best. Then we don't hear that still small voice. We don't respond to that anointing that is teaching us all things and teaches us to dwell in Jesus. We just basically self-justify and we make it all right. We call up a couple of people and say, well, why do you think? And of course, they agree and right with the prince of the power of the air because they entangled with it too. And that's the way that the world ultimately is caught into a net of a satanic lie and swept into what we call apostasy. It's all going to happen very harmlessly. It's all going to take place without anybody really realizing what's going on. Anyone who's got a voice that opposes it's going to be religious and weird. And someone from the, you know, some backwards person from somewhere long, long ago. But the reality of it is, his father's going to have his witness. He's got it today. He's going to have it throughout the time period in this transition. People think that at that time of the apostasy, there's going to be such a loud and thunderous voice warning people to not go that way. But I'm going to tell you, during the midst of the apostasy, what's going to happen is that voice is going to become fainter and fainter, weaker and weaker, and more despised. The good news is God's going to have a glorious church and a powerful witness. But just I'm talking about within the ranks of the deceived, it's going to become very faint. It's going to become not marginalized, but totally criticized and persecuted, as it were, to where that it doesn't exist within the realm of their relevance. So I hope you can begin to understand, you know, these things that I'm talking to you about, and hopefully before the end of the service this morning, it become more revelation to you. Hallelujah. Praise God. We just want the anointing to have free course in your life. We want the Holy Spirit to have an uninterrupted flow in the midst of your life. This is what God wants, and that's what's going to change the world. And Father doesn't. That's what's going to change this condition of America. That's what's going to reach the nations. That's what's going to be the witness of His glorious church. That's how Father's going to be able to use you more. That's how you're going to be able to grow, because you've just begun to come to a place where you just don't allow anything that would hinder or stop the flow of the anointing from your life, or anything that would somehow stand up against what God would want to do in your life to have any place in you. And suddenly, as you do that, those things that seem to be so harmless and ordinary and common in the world around you that was designed by the prince of the power of the air, the God of this world, is going to come and stand out to you like flashing neon blinking lights, bells and whistles and horns going off. You're going to go, how did I miss it before? You missed it before because you were entangled by it, simply because you didn't listen to the still small voice and you self-justified. Called up too many people that were willing to accommodate whatever it was. In reality, what took place is you listened to the voice of man instead of the voice of God. Today, we're believing that Father will give to you a soundness of understanding. He'll give you a sensitivity in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Pato rasanameke. That these things that God has declared in His Word will be bigger to you. They'll be more relevant to you. The voice of it and the impact of it will be more impactive to you than anything else that's going on in your daily life. Hallelujah. Well, you can be seated. Are you happy?
Yeah.
Look around people and say, man, I'm happy.
I'm happy.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah, we want you to do more than have a Merry Christmas. We want you to have a happy Jesus fest. We want you to be I want you to just understand, God wants you to be captivated by the gifts that He gave and the gift of the Holy Ghost, just letting that flow of heaven. People say, why don't I have a continual flow of heaven? Because you're distracted with the things that the prince of the power of the air, the God of this world, is doing. And so, I mean, where do I want to start with this? Because I want to talk to you about Moses, and I want to talk to you about the Assyrian, and I want to talk to you about the enemies of God's people and of Israel. And I want to talk to you about the things, the tools that Satan used around God and God's people to try to stop those things that the Lord has purposed to do in their lives, and help you understand that the same applies to you. And where I want to begin really is in 1 John chapter 4, but I've got a pull right now. You can open your Bibles to 1 John chapter 4. And I want you just to understand that from the very beginning, the demonic realm taught men disobedience from the very beginning. From the very beginning, the demonic realm came to interrupt the flow of the presence of God and the glory of heaven and the relationship that Father created us to have. When Satan came and led Adam into a disobedience, into a rebellion that brought him into a great stronghold of darkness and deception, and so much so that there wasn't really a means by which, and really there wasn't a means by which man could begin now to enjoy the presence of the living God. He had to wait for another day. Nothing's changed. The only thing that has changed is now on a bigger impact. Satan is still the prince of the power of the air, the God of this world, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. Everything about us, everything around us has been impacted by that atmosphere, has been impacted by that force and by that power that belongs to the category of the world. We don't get it because we've normalized it, we've commonized it, we've made it as it were harmless, but still. And what we do is we can so self-justify that we say, well, I'm just going so far into it, but not any further. But in reality, it still has an impact on the flow of His presence and of His glory. See, some people believe that the blood of Jesus Christ neutralized Satan's impact. It didn't. The blood of Jesus Christ delivered us from that realm of the power of darkness. The Spirit of the Lord came and changed our hearts so that now we can know what God is saying and agree with God. But the impact of the powers of darkness is still there. And if we're not careful, the operation that they work through in the realms of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life will begin to have an influence on us. And where we agree with it, we literally shut down the power of God, because we didn't realize that Satan designed these things to fight against God and His people. And so, when we look at Moses, Moses comes out of the presence of God. He comes with an anointing that conveys the presence of God. He comes with an anointing that clearly does break the yoke. And I'm going to talk about that verse of scripture here in Isaiah 10:26 here in just a little bit. But what's there to stop that flow? There's something there to stop their flow. And that is that Satan has put an anointing, if you would, an empowerment upon Jannes and Jambres, who through their connection with the demonic realm, which we call witchcraft or sorcery, we've got all these names that we make it so that we can categorically remove it from us. You see, we're not going to put rebellion in that category, because then we might, oops, be involved somehow in wickedness. Somehow we might be involved in the demonic. Somehow we might be involved in witchcraft, but God does equate them. But what we do is we say, oh, it's black magic or white magic, it's voodoo or hoodoo or something. You know, reality of it is, it's just those things created by Satan to fight against God, to fight against His influence, to fight against His anointing, to overthrow His work, His purpose, and His plan. Now, all of a sudden, if you would allow God the Holy Ghost to open up your eyes, you're going to get radical about this. And then, of course, you know, Satan's going to come along with his little gig and tell you you're religious. Because that's exactly what he does. Oh, you're just religious. I'm religious now because I want to wholly follow God and not have anything to do with the world. Label me. I'm a holy follower of the Holy Ghost. I want only be in His influence and no more demonic spirits. If that's religious, hello, I'm me. I'm here. I want to be that. Hallelujah. Are you listening to me? We got to understand. We live in an age right now. Satan will net men in the depths of apostasy, and no one will realize it. No one will realize it. It will be just a little bit more agreement, a little bit more compromise, a little bit going further into the realms of the demonic, and being baited into a place to where that you imprisoned a gin you don't even know you imprisoned. He's very subtle is what he does. He's very deceptive at what he does. I'm gonna stop for just a minute and say this. A man of God that I love very dearly has a friend who's a prophet, and the Lord showed this prophet something to open up his eyes so he could more effectively deal with the demonic realm. And that's my spin on it. So if my dear friend is watching right now, either one of them, you know, that's my disclaimer. The rest of the story is how God revealed it to him. This prophet guy just cast out a devil out of a person, and after he had done that and he had left that situation ministry, he was at home, and he went into a vision. And the vision, as he's in this vision, Satan is outside of his window. He's standing in a room praying. Satan's outside the room, outside the house, banging on the window, pointing to him, telling him, he's basically mouthing, you know, and pointing and gesturing and screaming type of songs, I'm coming in there to destroy you. I'm coming in there, you know, basically beat snot out of you. Okay? Layman's terms. Okay? And so Satan comes into the room, and And, you know, he puts up his fist like a boxer and tells the prophet, said, you need to put your fist up because he's coming at you. He starts walking around him like he's in a professional boxer. And then he stops and goes, wow, I'm really impressed with you. You know, the anointing God is in your life is amazing. I just want you to know that I think that the way you've been walking with God is tremendous. So he starts flattering. And then and other things went on. I don't want to make it too lengthy. Then he said to him, he said, you want to know how I deceived the mighty angels that stood before the Father and beheld his glory throughout the ages? And then he folded himself into a big accordion. And he began to play. And he began to play this glorious music of worship and praise unto the Father. The prophet says, the most glorious music I've ever heard. The most beautiful words of praise and adoration to the Almighty God that you could express. And it went on, verse after verse, course, and another verse of the most high praises. And then at the very end, he said, and worship me. That's it. And suddenly you begin to see that there are things, that subtle things that can begin to go on in our lives that we don't even understand, that we don't even consciously, you know, consider. We're the pride of life, a need to have something from someone else. Something becomes inordinate. You know, Satan takes out more people through the spirit of offense than any other trick, I think. It's probably one of the biggest ones, and it's so subtle because, boy, can you justify an offense? They did me wrong. Did you hear how I was treated? Did you hear what they said? Did you see what they did? Are you listening to me? I just want you to come to understand today that there is a battle raging, and the battle rages against God and his people. Ultimately, we see that at the Battle of Armageddon when it is fully realized, and that isn't a battle of man against God. That is a battle of the forces of Satan, of both angels and demons, of every devil and every power, and all mankind that was come alongside of him to stand up against God and his people. And that at that moment fully, if you would, exposes and reveals what you and I are engaged in right now, but just on another level. It doesn't seem quite so threatening, but your eternity is at stake. Your soul is at stake. Your forever is on the line. And so it should be very threatening. It should be overwhelming. Men in the chaos of darkness, they are bound by the powers of hell and of death. Suddenly, there comes on the scene a heavenly host singing, glory to God in the highest. Peace on earth, goodwill towards men. Today is born for you in the house of David, Christ the Lord. Come on, I mean, this announcement of salvation, of deliverance, so that you and I could now be delivered out of the power of darkness and translated over into another realm, another kingdom, to be on God's side. God found an Abraham that was willing to be on his side, and he went to the cradle of civilization, a place we call, referred to as Mesopotamia. In the capital city of Mesopotamia, for many years, there was a city called Ur. And there, every manifestation of Satan's demonic power and every manifestation of those things that Satan had taught man to do in opposing the anointing and opposing his purpose was there manifested. And God looked at Abraham and said, I want you to leave this place. And I'm going to tell you right now, there was such a heart within Abraham to know God and to no longer be impacted by these things that belong to the demonic. He didn't have to know where he was going. He heard the voice and said, I'm going with you. God's got one guy standing with him. One guy. He says, I want you to come over here on the other side of the flood. And the flood always refers to the realms of humanity and a separation. I want you, and he called him that day Ivrit. You could say Ivrit. Ivrit. You got to hold your tongue between your teeth on the last syllable. Ivrit. There you go. That means Hebrew. It's one who stands on the other side of the flood. Who's there? Who's God's army? God and Abraham. God doesn't need many. Satan goes walking up and down the midst of the earth. And he comes and stands before God, presents himself with the assembly of the sons of God and says, by inference. None of them are walking with you and serving you. They all serving me. God's got one guy. Between Abraham and Moses, God's got one guy. His name's Job. That's all Pops needs. I tell you right now, he's so sold out to me. He so doesn't want anything to do with your demonic realm and your influence. It don't matter what you do to him, he's going to be standing with me. People, I'll tell you, the book of Job is a great study. If you really want to understand deep biblical doctrine, it's all good doctrine. It's just misapplied. Those aren't wild doctrines. Those are established insights concerning the spiritual world and the operation of God. If you've never done a theological study, the book of Job, you're just missing out on some good insight, some good wisdom, some good revelation. So I'm telling you, don't miss out while you're doing something else, being involved in something else, distracted with some little game that Satan wants to play in your life. Because understand, not only one of the earmarks of the last day is seducing spirits and doctrine to devils and itching ears and men not enduring sound doctrine. It's also men being lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Just entertained, just caught away, just going with the flood of humanity and the flow of what everybody else is doing. But all those people at the end of the day feel empty inside. Something's missing. They're not complete. And you start talking about being complete, and you start talking about this glorious salvation, walking in this joy all the time, being filled with the Spirit. They're looking at you like you're telling some kind of story. You're putting on some kind of show because they've been too compromised. Look with me at this verse of Scripture here in 2 Kings. Well, no, I take one. Go with me to Isaiah chapter 10. Go to Isaiah chapter 10. Because it's a really good way to begin to kind of focus on. I don't want you to look at something that happened long ago. I want you to look and understand something that's going on in your life right now. I want to make this something that's actually an insight to the dynamics of what you are actually dealing with on a daily basis, of what you're interfacing with. I'm going to tell you, there's nobody who's ever been deceived that knew that they were being deceived while they were being deceived. God's word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. God, the Holy Ghost, has come to lead us and guide us in all truth. But if we don't obey his word and do what he says, if we try to compromise it, if we try to make it fit into our lifestyle, if we try to make it fit into our culture, it will lose its power and potency to save. The Spirit of the Lord has come to lead us and guide us in all truth. But if we're not willing to be led with him and walk with him, if we're not willing to consecrate in the way that he has commanded, if we somehow try to compromise that, we're going to find ourselves believing that we love God, but we love pleasure more. It's a scary thing. Because oh, we can all stand back and look at something that is blatant and obvious. I can't believe there's so many people sitting there listening to all that itching ear doctrine. What's going on with you? What's happening with you? God is looking for a people that will come and stand with him on the other side against all humanity. God's looking for some people that understand how to effectively stand when the forces of hell that have the ability to stop the flow of divine power and glory. You think about this. When God sent Moses to go and break the yoke by the anointing, I mean, he was vested with all the power that he needed, but yet there was still the opposing forces of darkness being able to stop the flow and the power that God himself was causing to be issued forth from Moses' life. It's good that Moses didn't back down from the persecution, because things didn't get better when he started preaching. It got worse. The congregation didn't get more excited. They got more divided. Are you listening to me? All of a sudden, they went from, you know, being slaves under their whip and under the taskmaster's authority of making bricks to making bricks without straw. It didn't seem to be a lot of proofs. Even though the miracles were there, there didn't seem to be enough proofs, because the result upon the people was a greater affliction, because they were thrown into They were thrust into the battle, into the heat of the battle, greater than they were before. And they didn't know what was going on. All they could do was measure it based upon their comfort and how it was working out for them. But praise God, there was a man who didn't bend or bow. He stood right there. Because God would take the anointing to a place that everybody had to say, wait a minute, this is the great power of God. We can't stop it no more. There is a conflict, and God will allow that conflict. I mean, everything that God has promised you, every inheritance that you have received in Christ Jesus, the powers of darkness will try to set up a fortified city so that you can inherit. By the time when Abraham left, I'll have to say this to you, when Abraham left the land of Canaan, there were no fortified hosts of demonic power and the demon manifestation, especially within the framework of giants, within that which he had purchased, for example, in the place that he bought for a birthplace for his, a burial place, kind of a birthplace, a burial place for his wife Sarah, Hebron, Kiriath Arba, as it became to be called. Why it would come to be called Kiriath Arba? Because by the time Israel is released from their bondage, now there is four giants, a manifestation of great demon power that is fortified and said, you can't have this inheritance. And this is from the King Og of Bashan all the way through. Satan had so fortified the promise and the inheritance that God had made for his people that it looked like that they were invincible cities. They were people that could not be overcome. In their presence, we were as grasshoppers. Satan doing everything he can do to overthrow the purpose and the plan that God has for his people. The battle rages. The battle rages for you and me. And if we don't see it, we're just going to go like, oh, you're just going to tuck tail and run, because we're not living after the ability and the wisdom to see what's going on in the realms of the spirit. We live as blind men, being now tossed to and fro by circumstances. Our lives need to be on the rock so when the storm comes, we don't budge. I hope you can hear me. Oh, I'm telling you the truth. I'm not talking to you a bunch of nonsense. I'm trying to come think something I could preach to you this morning. Occupy space and time. Hope you come back. I just want you to make heaven. I want you to be victorious. I'm going to tell you right now, the true earmark of the believer is the one who overcomes the wicked one. It's it. It's not the signs, it's not the wonders, it's not the miracle. It's to overcome the wicked one. Jesus said, if you overcome as I overcame, you will sit down with my throne, in my throne, as I've sat down with the Father in his. That's pretty radical. To understand this is the overcoming power that conquers the world. Amen. Even our faith. And that's not some Christian philosophy and ideology. The faith is that which Jesus Christ has brought to us by his blood when we were born by the Spirit and made a new creation. That is the faith. Christ in us. People that are the citizens of heaven, seated with him in a heavenly realm. That's the faith. I write unto you, young men, because the word of God abides in you. In other words, it dwells there, it rules you. It is a sovereign authority over your life, and you have defeated Satan at every point. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, you are in a battle. Somebody said the battle's over. You're in a battle. Amen. Somebody didn't know what they're talking about. You're in a battle. That's why Paul said the only way you're going to be able to deal with this battle is to be full of the Holy Ghost. And he expressed it this way. Be strong in the Spirit of the Lord and the power of his might. That's a whole lot of power. I believe that's an overcoming power right there. I did the job. But you're gonna suffer some, you're gonna suffer some persecution. You're gonna suffer some opposition. Huh? I promise you won't go through more than Jesus did. I promise you won't go through more than the children of Israel did. You listening to me? Huh? He says, taking yourself the whole armor, the whole supernatural abilities of protection, supernatural abilities of authority. Because you wrestle hand-to-hand combat. Bullets have run out. We've done lost our sword. We've thrown all the spears. There's no more arrows. We've lost the knives. They've been, say, stuck in somebody else by this point. Now you're down to bare hand-to-hand combat. Huh? It's fisticuffs, legs, knees, elbows, body slams. That's what it is. That's the word. That's the word. That's the word. I just want you to hear the word. You wrestle not against, you wrestle against spiritual wickedness. You wrestle against the armies of hell, the armies of the demonic, the armies that of Satan that Adam allowed into this world, that ultimately Christ Jesus will destroy at his coming. I just want to kind of look at this a little bit about how well we're able to do here, about how well off we are, how well equipped we are, how much power we got. Ha ha, hallelujah. Look over here, Isaiah chapter 10. Now in Isaiah chapter 10, this first scripture that I'm going to read to you, this is actually about the Battle of Armageddon. This is actually about the time in which Christ Jesus will come with his saints, but he doesn't really need much help. He shall slay the armies with one word of his mouth. Hallelujah. And we just get to ride along. Hallelujah. We just get to stand on the other side of the flood with him. We get to stand as those who always, in our heart and in our passion, in our will, oppose to everything that belongs to the demonic and the spirit of disobedience and the spirit of this world and the cultures of men and the governments of men and all that has been opposed academically and financially and intellectually and sociologically. People don't believe that. Why? Because the demon principality of humanism has moved in and has clouded the issue and has put a veil over people's eyes and has normalized the wickedness, has justified the opposing power of the Antichrist spirit and all that opposes God. Because that's all the Antichrist is. I'm going to talk about him here in a minute, 1 John 4. That's all he is. He's that which is anti-God. He opposes God. He opposes the anointing, and it's very subtle how it starts. I want you guys to pray for me, and pray over what God has opened up a door for us to do, because Charisma wants to publish my new book and sign the contract with them, and I'm believing that this book will cause the nations of the world, everyone that reads it, to tremble in the presence of the Lord like leaves on a tree in the midst of a windstorm. I believe it's going to be revelatory. It's going to open up people's eyes. It's going to cause them not to just think about the prophecy in the future, the prophetic scenarios as they're unfolding, but what they are dealing with and the decisions they're making about who they're going to serve and who they're going to live for right now, every day, every moment of the day. The battle rages hot. It's terrible when you see people walking around like they're shopping or at the mall or hanging out at Disneyland when the full-blown war for their soul is going on and they're clueless. Can't you just see that? Can you see that? Can you direct that? Can you imagine that? Huh? You have somebody walking around like they're at Disneyland and the battle is raging, people dying everywhere. They have no idea that every bullet, every missile, every weapon, every arrow, every spear is coming in their direction. It's clueless. Just flying all around. And what's worse is spiritually, they riddled. Spiritually, they riddled with the impacts of the satanic power that they've had no defense against. But here in Isaiah chapter 10, and start here in verse 23. For the Lord God of armies shall make a consumption. Hallelujah. Even determine in the midst of the land, God's got an appointed day. He's going to judge the wicked. And boy, you talk about relativism and humanism that has made so much sin okay. There's no sin okay that has made so much agreement with the world harmless, and nothing exists like that. It's a net of deception that keeps the anointing from being powerful in your life and the voice of the Holy Ghost from being overwhelming. God loves us. He's done everything he could possibly do to redeem us and make us his own, to teach us and to train us and to develop us in his way and equip us and fortify us against that wicked day and against every evil thing that Satan would throw at us. But we're going to have to be willing to recognize that we can't mix it up with the world and have God too, because we won't have the same conviction. We won't have the same insight. We won't have the same judgment. It will happen that way, little by little. He says concerning, and here, of course, the Antichrist is called the Assyrian, which is a revelation about him. You know, the Lord wants us to know everything about the strategies of Satan. That's what my book is really about, that Charisma is getting ready to print, publish for us. And I'm just blown away because it's God's worked a miracle. They're so excited about it. God has showed us exactly what Satan is doing, where he's going to hit at, what's going to happen before he appears, what he's setting up to make those, prepare the way for the worst things and the terrible things to happen. We just haven't really paid much attention, because Satan's able to run all the distraction by somebody who just wants to get fame and more money in their pocket. It's really all it comes down to. Just something that is sensational, and so we miss the revelation of the word. And here he describes the Antichrist as the Assyrian. He says, therefore, thus saith the Lord God of hosts, O my people that dwell in Zion. Hallelujah. I'm one of those. Did you know that you're one of those?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Now, I know that the application here is really about Israel, but I can get excited because I know that I was included. The Apostle Paul, who was a great revealer of the word, said so in Hebrews chapter 12. Hallelujah. About verse 23. Amen. I know where I'm at right now. I'm in the holies of holies. I'm not visiting. I'm living there. We're going to talk about that here. Just, we'll bring that up here in just a minute. I'm living there. I'm living in the Mount Zion. Hallelujah. I'm standing before the living God. I'm in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm standing in the realms of the kingdom right now. I'm captivated by all that God is doing. So much so that anything that Satan's doing becomes extremely obvious to me. I can feel it, even though it comes so subtly that no one else can even recognize that it's the demonic. Because it's so disguised as an angel of light. I'm not touching it. I'm fixated. I'm absolutely captivated by the glory of the person who's the author and finisher of my faith, Jesus.
Amen.
I'm overwhelmed by the pleasures that are in his presence forevermore, that the Holy Ghost supplies to me as floods from heaven. Woo! People, this is a living and dwelling and abiding in Jesus. That's why the anointing teaches us. We've received an anointing from him. And know all things. You received an unction from God, and you know everything. That's pretty radical. First John chapter 2. You received an anointing from him. You don't need that anybody teach you anything. But as the anointing has taught you in his truth, you should come and dwell in him. The only place of victory, the only place of authority, the only place of preservation, the only place that is going to keep you. You listen to me. From an eternity without God, your soul is on the line. It's not about your opinion and my opinion. It ain't about what somebody did around you versus what you did. You better listen to God. You better let the word of God have free course in your life. You better let that stuff that's been messing with your head and running interference against the word of God be shut down once and for all. Otherwise, you'll find yourself going from day to day into a deeper realm of darkness. And all the time, you will be right. And all the time you could read the Bible and there's a veil over you and a blinder over your eyes and you won't be able to understand. One of the things that the Lord reveals to Daniel, he says only the people who walk in righteousness and purity and holiness can behold these hidden things. So he tells Daniel concerning the abomination of desolation. Go read about it. How many people who are clean separated from the influence of the demonic are able to behold and understand these things? I think it's probably, even though it's just right there, somebody points it out to you. God's allowing us to point it out. Praise God. We're going into 2016 with some things happening. We're just so excited. I mean, if you just walk faithfully with the Lord, It doesn't matter how much opposition. We've had opposition after opposition after opposition. Everything that Satan could possibly do to run interference against us, to persecute us, to say and spread and tell lies about us and distort things has been one after another. To the point, you know, you can easily just say, you know what? After 35 years of this, I'm giving up. You can say that after 15 years. And I hope every one of you are saying, I'm with you. I'm not going to give up either. Because it's easy to give up or to cut back or to let up. Maybe you don't totally give up, but you let up. You start backing down a little bit. No, get up in his face a little bit bigger. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Get up in his face a little bit bigger.
Yeah.
Because if you walk faithfully with God, he's going to prepare you. He's going to shape you. Huh? When you learn to have people persecute you and say all manner of evil against you, but really in your heart there's nothing but blessing for them. And don't even affect you no more. You can't even work an offense in your life. You're about ready to be used by God and not destroy you. Come on, people. Yes. Learn how to open up your mouth to praise, and for all other purposes, keep it closed. Amen. Hallelujah. Until you learn, because if you do that, God the Holy Spirit will come and give you grace. In other words, he'll give you a divine ability to not be touched by it. You'll be like a fenced city. You'll be a fenced city. What does that look like? It's like a knight with all of his armor on, his metal is all over him from head to toe, like a fenced city. Nothing can hurt you. You can walk right through the midst of the thorns and the briars and all the other stuff, and you're not unscathed by it. Hallelujah. We're going in 2016 prepared of the Lord. We go in 2016 in expectation of a great thunderous shout of God through our lives. We just want you guys to, in every way, to lift up your heads, because your redemption draws nigh. The purposes of God in your life and the calling of God of your life hasn't somehow been, you know, abandoned and removed and somehow canceled or delayed. Come on. Just pick up the pace. Just pick up the pace. Just come start running with the Lord. Just start seeking him more. Recognize that the demonic realm is that power that's distracting you from your prayer time, from your church time, from the word time. Make sure that you understand what the Father is saying and you're willing to respond to him and obey. Because that's where he's going to prepare you and strengthen you and give you the ability and fence you. He's more interested in your salvation and your preservation than he is in using you. He wants to use you. But when he looks at our life and says, no, I can't yet, because if they go into that kind of usefulness, they're going to get shut down, and I got something bigger that I want to do in their life than to get shut down. So I just want you to be confident in God. I want you to say, hallelujah. In all my tribulation, I'm exceeding glad, because I know that this suffering is present suffering. Is it worthy to be compared with the glory that's about to be revealed? Come on, you're just going to have to understand it. You got to get dance a little bit more. Get excited over the troubles and over the problems. I know my Redeemer lives. Hallelujah. And more than being able to say, and he shall stand upon the earth in the last day, we can say, and he's standing inside of me right now. I mean, come on. You think about how much more we have than those of the past, but we run the risk of doing far less with it. Come on, people. You don't need the praise of men. You need the praise of God. You don't need to be seen on the stage of humanity. You need to be seen on the stage of heaven. Hallelujah. Too many people looking for the wrong kind of praise, looking for the wrong kind of influence. We're going in a good place. Most of you in here in 60 years from now, I'll see you on the other side. We will have broken through the barrier. We will be standing there beholding it. Woo! Hallelujah. We won't be naked. We won't be going, hey, who won't wonder who the... Is that Ruth Anna? No, because we won't be naked, but we'll be clothed upon with the tabernacle from the Lord, an ability to stand in a spiritual body waiting for the resurrection of our earthly one. Oh, yeah, go read 2 Corinthians chapter 5. God's got it all fixed up. He's got a great plan. He didn't miss one. There's no oops with God. There's no oop, I forgot. Oh, I didn't think about that one. He prepared for us everything. Woo! I'm telling you right now. Somebody say, you got a retirement program. Yeah, Jesus. I've got heaven. I've got all the riches of heaven. I've got a place in the beloved that is an eternal realm of divine blessing. So do you. It's a lot to live your life for. It's a great reward. Whew. Hallelujah. I want you to look here at this verse of scripture with me. Verse 24, therefore thus saith the Lord God of hosts, O my people that dwells in Zion, don't be afraid of the Assyrian. Amen. Now he's going to come. He's going to come. And of course, people have been around me, you know this. You know that there'll be the rise of the empire of the ten kings. They'll be on the earth far before the Antichrist comes. At least a period of time before the Antichrist comes. That's not going to happen until there's going to be a world war. These things are revealed in the Word of God. The nations, all these nations form into 10 kingdoms and a confederacy of 10 kings. And he's going to rise up out of the midst of that. And, you know, we're going to be able to see clearly what is going to be happening, what's happening, what he's going to be doing. But nonetheless, he's going to come in. He's going to oppress us. He will oppress Israel. He will deport them and afflict them even after the manner as they were afflicted in Egypt, you see. This is part of the reason, one of the many reasons why we know that Scripture is clearly about the coming Antichrist, because that hasn't happened, really. That hasn't happened. And some of you would say, well, there's a certain amount of that happened with Sennacherib. But no, what God is saying here hasn't fully been realized. He said, he shall smite thee with a rod and shall lift up his staff against thee after the manner of Egypt. Okay, so this is how the Antichrist is going to oppress Israel. For a little while, and the indignation shall cease in my anger, and my anger shall cease in their destruction. Now here's how we know, because this is what the Lord's going to do. He's talking about something that hadn't been done yet. Listen to this. He said, and the Lord of armies shall set up a scourge for him according to the slaughter of the Medes. The Midians or the Medes, okay? He's going to do something for them in the future like that happened in the past. For the Lord of hosts shall set up a scourge for them according to the slaughter of the Medes at the rock of Oreb. And as the rod was upon the sea, so shall he lift it up after the manner of Egypt. Verse 27, and it shall come to pass in that day that his burden, the burden of the Antichrist, the burden of the satanic realm, the burden of every power of darkness that wars against us to try to keep us from doing and being what God has commanded us to do and to be, is going to be broken from off of the shoulder and from off the neck, for the anointing will destroy of that yoke. Now looky here. I want you to just go real quickly with me over to Ezekiel. I mean, sorry, 2 Kings. Go with me to 2 Kings and look quickly with me in chapter 19. And he said he's going to destroy them and slaughter them just like he did. He's going to lift up his power against them in like manner as he did at the rock Oreb when he fought against the Medes, right? Well, let's look at what he did when he fought against the Medes. Are you with me? One angel comes in verse 35. You looking here? And it came to pass that night that the angel of the Lord went out and smote the camp of the Assyrian. So now understand, this is when God did battle against the Assyrians, focused on the Medes, the Medians, all right? This is when he did battle in the past that Isaiah is referring to, of how he's actually going to do something even greater in the future. Are you with me? So he says here, he says, and it came to pass that night that the angel of the Lord went out and smote the camp of the Assyrians, and he got and one angel stood there. This is the kind of authority you and I have. This is the kind of place and position you and I have of protection and strength and divine ability to stand against the enemies of God that want to destroy God and destroy his people. And all these things that you see in the past in these wars and all of these threats against Israel from these various different nations like Egypt and Assyria and Babylon, all that is personifying what you're actually going through right now as you engage in the spiritual war, not only over your soul, but over the masses that God would use you to reach. that Satan knows about, should the anointing begin to be manifested through you, the anointing that destroys off the satanic yoke, the authority of Satan to deceive and to hold under his power of deception and his power of iniquity? Well, let's look at this. One angel in one night destroys 185,000. They were all dead corpses, just standing there. Huh? He didn't have to touch anybody. He just stood there. Are you with me? He just stood there. He just looked. He looked. I mean, it from stories like this, it had become developed, a theology had become developed, that if any angel stared at you, you were dead. Oh, no, I'm dead. Over and over again, you'll hear this. I'm a dead man. I just saw an angel. I just saw something in another realm. I'm dead. This means I'm dead. Because of certain events like this. Now, let's just think about, let's take it to another level. Huh? Of course, there's other stories like this. You know, when David numbered Israel, and because he did something that he wasn't supposed to do, angel of the Lord comes, basically, as it were, unsheathed his sword and pointed it towards Israel, right? And 70,000 people died quickly. Huh? Think about that. Think about the influence of standing in the presence of an angel. Think about the authority and the power a single angel has. Now let's think about the power and authority Jesus got. Now let's take it to a whole nother level. If an angel has that kind of impact, I guarantee you what God wants to do is going to do far more than just knock you over for a few seconds. You lay there and look around for a minute. Come on, people. If you can't stand on your feet, I understand. And you should just, I mean, I want to go out. I mean, basically, you know what I'm saying? I love being overwhelmed in the presence of the Lord. I'm not going to stand there and try to resist the anointing. But the thing about it is, it's going to be more than just a little flop and a 30-second, baking in the presence of the Lord. I mean, John said he felt like a dead man before his presence. I mean, John hung out with Jesus, but now he's hung out with Jesus for more than 3 years. But now he's seeing Jesus in all of his glory, in his resurrection glory, and he falls before him as a dead man, can't even move. Same thing happened to Daniel. Same thing happened to everybody else who encountered the Lord. I'm interested in being able to so walk with God to where a greater manifestation of his power and glory can be revealed to me. And through me, we can look at Paul. He fell to the ground. I mean, the overwhelming presence of his divine glory, it shuts the mainframe down, it shuts the infrastructure down. I mean, it's like some kind of big, huge magnetic force that shuts down all the power plants. I mean, you just can't function, You're just out. You're out. And the beauty and the splendor of it and the glory of it and the insight and the revelation of it, of having interacted with heaven, the fortifiable defense that's in it. Come on. Father has more for you and me than what we've been experiencing. It's just like we think we get there and we quit being as hungry and thirsty because we think we got it all. I mean, nobody got it all. He wants us to have it all. We just got to keep moving forward. We keep following on to know him. We got to keep, There's got to continue to be an ever-growing, increasing hunger and passion, because that's what encounters with God will result in, a greater hunger, a greater passion. Hallelujah. Not just camp around some expression. I remember, growing up, and I'd watch some people go, when they start praying, they start going, doing this thing, right, like this, and they start kind of doing this, and I'd say, well, why does so-and-so do that? Well, that was happening back in 1940. People would start quaking under the power of God. He's still in 1940. I mean, I'm sure it's a real expression, but he's still in 1940. And then see somebody else with another expression. Well, what's that? Oh, God was doing that in the Latter Rain Revival. They're still in 1958. We in 2015, 2016 now. We're coming in 2016. Come on, the Lord wants to increase. He wants a greater manifestation of more of the fullness of his glory in our life. He's looking for us to respond. He's looking for us to say, he comes and he says, behold me. He comes and he lays hold on us so that we will in turn lay hold on him. He jumped out and he laid hold on Jacob so that Jacob would turn around, you know, do the reverse Nelson thing and lay hold on him. And God said, let me go. He goes, no. He disobedient right there. No, I'm not going to let you go. Because he's laying hold on a blessing. Whew. Look at what that one wrestling match with God did. A nation was born. Israel. One who lays hold on God. It's not one who wrestles God. It's one who lays hold on God. I'm one who lays hold on God. I belong to that company of and type of people that have encountered the Almighty, and it has not been bestowed upon me in vain. You think about what God has already given you. Has that been bestowed upon you in vain, or is it a treasure and a riches to you that you're tapped into and so thankful for and so blessed about? Or do you get distracted with all the stuff that's going on and the demonic, and now it begins to run interference and it begins to attract you to where that all of a sudden this pleasure realm has taken you to a place where the riches of his glory aren't quite as valuable to you no more? God, be careful. I want you to turn, look now with me. This verse of scripture in 1 John. And I'm just going to give you two verses of scripture. And I want this to change your life. Amen. I don't want you to be a hearer and then walk out of here and not be a doer. I'm going to tell you right now, you know, I've been walking with the Lord for a long time. And you know what I've discovered? Father wants change of me every day. Those of you who think that you can be the same and you're good to go, you've been deceived. God wants change of you. And if you'll come in the anointing and you'll come into the fellowship with him, it will result in glory to glory. It will result in a continual ongoing grace of maturity and growth. It's not changing the heart. That's nonsense. You know what I'm saying? You have to be completely changed by the salvation power of God and be made a new creation that belongs to God 100% through and through, so that you can have the kind of change I'm talking about. So I want nobody misunderstanding me. Amen. I'm not talking about you somehow adding to what Jesus did at Calvary. Amen. I'm talking about you growing and benefiting from what he did at Calvary. Hallelujah. Basoka, growing in. Pataraman, maturing in. Hallelujah. Bokorisitanemeya. Hallelujah. Blessed is the name of the Lord. All you got to do is stay in the presence of the Lord. This happens automatically, you see. Like a tree planted in the house of the Lord. Huh? A tree doesn't have to strain to grow. But you put it in the wrong place and it's going to die. It'll be straining to grow then. Hallelujah. You're listening to me. I want you to get some revelation. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Go put the tree in a dark put the tree in a dark room. Put the tree right back there. See how long it lasts. It's not in the right place. We may be a young and tender olive tree. Amen. When we start off, we may be like a small sapling. But if we plant it in the presence of the Lord, hallelujah, we won't look nothing like ourselves. Come about. Come on, you think about it. Go stand and look at the great redwoods. I mean, the ones that's just like the trees of Lebanon. You can't see the tops of them that are like 6 to 8 foot in diameter. They don't look nothing like it did when it was a sapling. You go look at a sapling. It's like, that is what that used to be. No way. Yeah, way. That's exactly what it was. And it was no problem. All I had to do is stay right there in that place and go right there. But go take and try to plant it in some other kind of environment. Try to bring it down here in San Diego. See what happens to it. It'll struggle to grow. It will struggle to grow. Huh? Take some of these palm trees and take them up there where the big redwoods are. Huh? Well, look what's going to happen to it. It's going to look like many Christians. Ain't in the right spot. Then it looks like it's still got all the basic elements. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You know what? It's still got oxygen, still got sunlight, still got soil. listen to me. I hope you can understand. I hope you hear. Botai est bokanapata. Bektan stakint stapakate. Terapania. Somebody said, what did I say? Something right into your spirit. And it don't make a difference because you don't believe it or understand it. It's still true and powerful, and it blessed you anyways. Hallelujah. You got blessed out of it whether you believe it or not. Kantamo shipata. Hallelujah. Ripana say. Lutane stura. Ndongea magete ke. Halanjete nate moksata. Mengsi kingsta. Mengsi kistantekti. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What God will do when we just let Him, when we just cooperate with Him. This is how the whole thing works. So I'm going to just look here with me quickly in 1 John chapter 2. Thank you, Jesus. I feel like dancing. I feel like dancing now. That embarrassed. If I start dancing right now, well, I feel embarrassed every one of you.
No, we'll join you.
It embarrassed just about every person here got any respectability. Anybody that's been over humanized, you'd be just absolutely feel like me. You just need to get up and leave. I want you to just be so overwhelmed with the presence. The Lord, you begin to act like the seraphims do in His presence. And they're not rejoicing over their redemption. They're not rejoicing over all the mercy that's been shown to them. They're just rejoicing over the beauty of what it was like being in His presence. Whoa! It's inexpressible. I mean, it's more radical, more overwhelming than going on the most craziest, roller coaster you've ever been on, dropping in the biggest wave you've ever, whatever overwhelming thing that went, His presence. I've tasted the realm. I know, I get to see a glory that's beyond what I've tasted of in the Word of God. The fundamental beauty of the anointing is that the anointing that we've received is teaching us this simple thing that we don't need anybody to teach us because we already know it. Because we receive the unction, we know these things. We know all these things about what God has purposed and what He's willed and what He wants us to be. And what He's willed and what He's purposed is us to come over and live and dwell in Him. That's more than living and dwelling in His presence. That's more than the seraphims got while they're basically flying and worshiping and praising and shouting over the great ecstasy and glory and awe of being in His presence. He's called us to come and dwell in Him, to see understanding that the whole purpose of who you think you are, your conscience, your psyche, all the dimensions of your purpose and being is all defined within the framework of your conscious willingness to say, I am in Jesus. Aaron could not stand before the Lord and be the priest that bore the iniquity of Israel unless he had his plate going across his little crown, said, holiness unto the Lord.
Hallelujah.
He said, you've got to have that plate on so you can remember what you are. You different. As you're standing here in the place of the priest and you're dealing with the forgiveness of the sins of Israel, you can't see yourself all condemned and all beaten down and someone that's not worthy to approach enemy. You got to come with a revelation on your mind and on your thinking that you are holiness unto the Lord. Otherwise, God will not respect your intercession. Go read it. To come and find our whole dwelling in it, to say, my whole life is in Him. That's what we do when we're having communion. My whole life is Him. I'm living by the light that He has poured out for me. I'm dwelling in Him. I refuse to be dwelling anywhere else. Satan and all that he's doing comes out to oppose that. To shut down the anointing, to kill the anointing, to destroy any league with God. or any expression of his divine power and authority. As soon as God anointed Joshua, the son of Josedek, that you read about in Zechariah, what's the first thing that happens? God says, take his filthy garments off of him and give him holy garments. That's what the Lord did when you were born again.
Amen.
It says, put upon him this crown of glory. Put upon him this majesty and put upon him this glory realm of consecration that gives him the ability and the authority and the insight and the wisdom to stand before me. And as soon as that happened, Satan stood there to stop him and to resist him and said, you cannot be this. You cannot do this. You have no right. Zechariah chapter 3. That's about you. That's about me. That's about us. Satan comes out to oppose every manifestation of God's presence and of God's power. Satan's whole purpose and whole design, the way he hunts the souls of men with his net, is through sin, just as he did with Adam, just as he did with Jesus. He came out to say, to try to teach Jesus iniquity, to try to teach Jesus sin. Even as he, with his angels and devils and their demon spirits have influenced man since the fall and taught man sorcery and magic and warfare and all forms of iniquity and all forms of unbridled lust and lasciviousness and immorality. So he comes with the same thing to try to lead us by little subtle things. If you're the Son of God, prove it. That's the demonic realm. Sin is not just some kind of little ideas and whimsical thoughts that went rushing around in your head. It is a demonic influence imposed upon us by the spirit of disobedience, the God of this world. And about the time you get yourself in the midst of the warfare and realize what's really going on, you're going to understand that more is with you than are with them, and you're going to be able to stand up against this stuff. You're going to recognize, wait a minute, my whole life is about dwelling in Christ Jesus. I'm bought with a price. I'm not my own. I don't even have a choice here anymore. I'm not going to be deceived. I'm going to do what God said for me to do. I'm not going to take my will that has now been given over to the Lord. I'm not going to take my life that has now been transformed and changed by the Lord and go decide what I'm going to do and what choices I'm going to make. I'm going to live by the Word and walk in Spirit. I said, I'm going to live by the Word and walk in the Spirit. That's why I was born again. That's why I received this so great a salvation, so that I could live by the Word and walk in the Spirit. Because before then, all of it was just foolishness to me. I couldn't understand it. It didn't mean anything. Chapter 4. Beloved, believe not every spirit. Be one, go try to take this, find out whether or not I'm a man of God. Give me a break. You need to find out whether or not you're a man of God. You need to find out what spirit you're listening to and what's about. Look at the decisions that you're making and the things you're getting yourself involved in and whether or not you're able to stand against sin and temptation and say to the powers of darkness, I'm bought with the blood of Jesus Christ. I'm born of the Spirit. I'm an heir of God, a joint heir with Jesus Christ, and I command you in the name of the Most High, get yourself and go now. Huh? Yeah. Hallelujah. That's the anointing. That's dwelling in him. That's an authority. Huh? Somebody said, who do you think you are? I'm going to tell you, I got a high opinion of myself.
Yes.
I'm bought with the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Woo! I'm born of the Spirit. Mazataya. I don't need to be anything more than that. A blood-bought son of God. I'm a child of the King, heir and joint heir with the Master. Come on. If you're not careful, your interaction with the world around you and the things that you come addicted to, you can become addicted to a lot of different things that don't even know it. I'm not going to go into that. I just want you to get along with God. Let him sort that out for you. Things that keep you from the presence of the Lord. Things, and when I say presence of the Lord, I'm talking about intimacy with him. about abiding, dwelling in him, about enjoying his presence, being overwhelmed with the mind of Christ and the mind of the Spirit. Hallelujah. The privilege and the gifting and the power and the authority that we have to be able to put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Woo! Like a coat, you know. Hallelujah. Like an authority. That's what the anointing teaches us. Put the coat on, don't take it off. Jesus' name. Beloved, believe not every spirit. Try the spirits where they are of God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. Hereby we know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come into the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ has come into the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that should come into the come, and even now is already in the world. This is the spirit that wars against God's salvation, that wars against God's purpose, that wars against God himself, and every blessing and every healing and every deliverance and every salvation. It's more than what we make it. It's more than how we reduce it to whether or not you got all your doctrines and theology right. No, this is talking about the life, the abundant life, the new life, the life of the Spirit, the redemption life, the life that now that makes us the people of the living God. This is the bigger picture over here. This is the warring spirit of hell that does everything that it can do to stop the gospel message, to stop you, to stop every flow and expression and manifestation of the power of the name of Jesus and the glory of the Holy Ghost. But here's what he says. But you are of God, little children, and you have overcome them. You have gone out to meet them on the battlefield and destroyed them. Amen. You went out to meet them on the battlefield and won. Hallelujah. Huh? Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Why? Because you got an angel beside you with his sword drawn, as it was in the day that God came out against the Medes at the Rock of Oreb. No. No. Because you have the living God, thus the only begotten Son of God, the Almighty, eternal God, the living Word, living, dwelling on the inside of you. Yes. Because greater is he that is in you. Because you purposed yourself, look at this, you purposed yourself to dwell in him. Because you purposed yourself to dwell in him, look at the reciprocation. He dwells in you. Huh? Because you're willing to find your habitation, the place that you want to live, being in him. He's come inhabit you. That insight, that fellowship, that relationship brought to us by the Holy Ghost would be working in our life to shut down what we're watching, to shut down what we're hearing, that is a distraction, is working within our life a compromise, to shut down all the other things that would be going on that results in the moving of the Holy Spirit to become, as it were, faint. And when there's a continual flow, there is a means by which we can redeem the days, because they're evil. There's a means. And that is to be continually filled with the Spirit. To have a continual overwhelming. Hallelujah. You know, I love the fathers of the faith and the people who've gone before us, who've walked in the glory, who touched that realm of heaven. You know, there's a lot you can still go on, you can do, you can be more productive. Father doesn't just have us sitting around in the living room praying. There are some people who've really had major impacts. Did you know there's people that's had some major impacts on the world sitting in a living room praying? Did you know that? One of the guys' name was Father Nash. He sat in a living room praying. He would go into a town and Father Nash would begin to cry out to God and pray. And then when Charles Finney came into the town, the place was leveled by the presence of God. Charles Finney said that when Father Nash didn't go before him into that place of prayer and anointing that was upon his life, it wasn't the same. It was a team. Think about Father Nash. He goes and he builds a church in upstate New York. And because he's 48 years old, the church fired him because they wanted a younger preacher that could relate more to the younger people in the community. He's like this gigantic failure. And the church never really got that big anyways. So he plants a church, and he's betrayed by the people. And now he's like, I'm 48 years old. Obviously, I'm not very good at preaching. Obviously, I don't have much of an anointing. But look what God took him and did with him, because he would not let go. People, come lay hold on the one who's laid hold on you. Come take full of advantage of being able to dwell in him and have your habitation in the Lord. Come on, man. Don't count this thing some small, thing in your life. Some option, as it were, among the other choices. It is the greatest thing that could have ever happened to you and me. Redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ, washed in his blood, born of the Spirit, so that now you and I could both occupy and be occupied by the Lord Jesus Christ. That we can both dwell in him and have him dwell in us. We want to get you into this great salvation today. If you do not know that Christ Jesus has come to live and dwell on the inside of you, that change has got to come. You can't just be a nominal Christian and say, well, I believe in God, but I'm not sure about all these things. You need to know. There's so many people that have just left it over into a realm of uncertainty. The Lord wants you to know. He's given us understanding that we may know him. You need to know. Do you know that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life? If you don't, God wants to change that, and he wants you to have that assurance of salvation right now, today. It will make the difference of your eternity. I don't believe that you have saving faith when you don't have knowing faith. Do you know that your sins have been washed away? Do you know that he's come to dwell on the inside of you, that he literally lives in you, that he is in you, that God walks in you? I know that the spirit of this world fights against the knowledge of God, fights against the word of God, fights against the reality of that which God has done by his power. So I understand those moments of uncertainty as the battle rages. But I'm talking about at this moment, in this time, do you know that you've been born again? That you received a new heart and a new spirit? If you don't, Father in his loving kindness and tender mercy stands knocking at the door of your heart, just as it was with the same kind of love the day that he poured out his love by giving Jesus at Calvary's cross. He stands with the same kind of intercession, with the same kind of grace, the same kind of mercy, the same kind of power that has been extended to any single person, no matter who they are, whether it's the Apostle Paul or Peter or anybody else in the New Testament or anybody that you knew that walked in the glory of the authority of God. He stands right before you right now with the same grace and the same mercy to change you, to establish you, to cause you to walk in a calling and a grace and a mantle that goes beyond anything that you could ever achieve for yourself or obtain for yourself. He's here to change everything about your life. He's here to deliver you from the authority of hell. He's here to deliver you and empower you with the ability to stand against every sin and everything that Satan would throw at you. Are you certain today that Christ Jesus lives in you? If you're not, he wants to step into your life. Are you certain today that your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life? If you're not, he wants to show you that it's inscribed there. Are you certain that you received a new heart and a new spirit? If you're not, God's got the miracle for you right now. Would you stand with me? God's got the miracle for you right now. Father has a miracle for you right now. Father wants to, in his grace, in his mercy, he wants to move us from the casual, from the ordinary, to the amazement, to the awe of what he's done for us. Father wants to move you from the place that you've come to understand about him up to this point and cause you to see where you go, you've got to be kidding me. It's really this big, it's really this real, it's really this majestic, it's really this powerful. Yes. I want everybody, please, just, I want you to just close your eyes and shut everything else out. I want God to be able to talk to your heart. As I look across this room this morning, I can see that everybody in this place, because I know everyone that's here, that you've called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I tell you, in calling upon him, it wasn't in vain. It wasn't just idle words. He heard you. But there are those here today, you've not been willing to believe the report that God gave you. And I want those things that Satan has done to harass you and torment you and somehow make you think that you are less than that which God described in his word, I want that broken off of you today in the name of Jesus. I want you to rise up in the glory of the only begotten Son. I want you to begin to live by the Spirit, that oneness with the Holy Ghost, where you rise up in the same glory, the same majesty, the same certainty, same confidence. Today, right now, in Jesus' name, we believe God for the change. Bandosteya. We believe God for the change. Etarosteya paneya. I want every person in this place to let the floodlight of heaven shine upon your soul and let God show you. Let Father show you how to stand in the battle, how to be strong in his word and his spirit, how to deal with the things that you've allowed to be compromises in your life, how to shut out those things that you've allowed to creep into your life that aren't supposed to be there, that have somehow diluted the word of God and decreased, as it were, his manifest presence. We're not looking for the same, and by no means are we willing to allow something less, because we're so desperate for something more. And you really don't have to get... Listen. You don't have to get distraught about it all. Just got to be willing. Jesus. 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 If there's anyone standing here, you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost, just lift your hands towards heaven right now and receive what God has for you. Because I'm telling you right now, it's not about God not being willing to do it. He's willing. And it's not like there's some kind of, you know, terrible thing wrong with you. No, it's just that you allow the enemy to hinder you. Quit allowing the enemy to hinder you. Just start receiving what God has for you. Make God bigger than anything else in your life. Make His word bigger than anything else in your life right now. Don't wait. There's nothing that Father's poured out from heaven that He is withholding from you. Hear me. There's nothing that God has poured out from heaven that He is withholding from you. Hear me. There's nothing that's been provided in Christ Jesus that He's withholding from you. There's nothing that He's provided by the Holy Ghost that He's withholding from you. So just go ahead and receive right now. Just go ahead and take a hold of this overcoming power that overcomes the world. With your heart. Just respond. Say, Lord, I'm going all the way with you. With your heart, you just respond and say, Holy Ghost, all I want's that which you supply. It's really that easy. You start talking to the Lord that way, then you end up in some place doing something you're not supposed to be doing. The Lord's going to say, well, what are you doing now? What are you doing here? Is this your company of people? What are you doing here? Are these the practices that you've learned from me? Oh, yeah. And then His voice, His Holy Ghost conviction, and the sound of His instruction all of a sudden begins to become louder and more impacted in your life. Amen. This is a walk with the Lord. This is a relationship. This is a fellowship because you want to be in heaven. You belong to Him. He's your God and you're His people. You're on His side. He's on your side. And you're not falling out to God's enemies and hanging out with them for a while. Oh God, I'm going to go over here and hang out with your enemies for a while, those who hate you. Her enemies of everything that belong to the anointing and your purposes. I'll be back a little later. See, there's a work that took place in our life when we were born again. And it's called sanctification. It's called being set apart only for God. And that is only defined within the framework of those vessels that were brought into the holy place and into the holies of holies. God brought us into the kingdom to live in His glory, to live in the holies of holies. I come into the holies of holies by the blood of the Lamb and I'm not going out. With all boldness. So we want you to just get into a place of rejoicing and joy and fellowship and walking with the Lord. And if there's places in your life where you have fallen out to the enemy and you've been captivated by the pleasure of this world, the lust, the pleasure that is in the realms of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life, just recognize that at that moment in time, you are in a place so vulnerable because you so drifted from the presence of the Lord. And all you have to do is just come back. All you can do is just open wide your heart. Just come back into that place of intimacy with Him, of letting Him fill you and overwhelm you. And then those things have no value, have no more power over you. Thank you. The hour is late. Time's very urgent. You don't have time no more to diddle-dally around making decisions. Time to choose this day who you serve. It's time for you to choose this day who you serve. You need every second. You need every minute. You need every day of preparation. Every hour. Time is urgent. If there's those of you here today that you've never found this place of living the overcomer's life, where Satan comes at you but he has nothing in you, therefore he's not able to lead you into his iniquity. If you've not found that place, you're going to have to find it. You're going to have to get serious with God enough to where it doesn't matter. Whatever you need to do, you'll do it. Whatever's necessary, you'll count the value of your eternity and the value of your soul more important to you than to diddle-dally around with stuff anymore. It's time. If the powers of darkness and their influence are going to be broken off the world around us, oh, we can't remain the servants of sin. If God doesn't have a people who are so given over to his realm of authority and power, which Satan has no ability to hinder, there's not going to be any great revival or awakening. Because what God is going to do, he's going to do in the midst of his people and through his people that have been given over, consecrated to him. And what Father has purposed to do has no deception in it. What Father has purposed to do has no little thing in it. He's purposed that there should be a great outpouring, that there should be a great manifestation of his glory and of his power. And he wants to do those things through you. And I'm going to tell you right now, in case you didn't know, there's more that are with us than are with them.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Even though we don't need more. Seeing as the creator of heaven and earth lives on the inside of us.
Yeah,
Jesus. Father, we thank you that in your mercy and your love, you established this faith, this revelation, this great salvation in every person's heart, that they'll recognize that you live and dwell on the inside of them. And the Satan is no match for the living word, the only begotten Son of God. That there's no power of sin or power of hell that will be able to prevail against to you, Lord, our Lord Jesus. Father, I thank you right now for the healing. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. I thank you for the healing. I thank you for healing power right now in Jesus' name. I'm sure that it's probably someone that is not here right now, but you're watching me by the web. And I can see in a vision, I can see a person who's had so much of the spirit of suicide on them that you've even actually gone so far as to cut yourself at your wrist. I want you to understand that demon power has purposed to destroy your soul in hell for eternity. And I break the authority of it off of you now in Jesus' name.
Yes.
It will no longer be able to harass you and torment you. I free you. I free you. I release you from the power of that demon spirit now in Jesus' name. You go free. You're free. I'm going to say this too. When you're unwilling to believe, to be conscious of, and it almost would be like wearing it as a plate upon your head, that Christ Himself, the eternal Word, the living God, lives and dwells and abides on the inside of you, it would be like cutting off your right hand, standing for your ability, your power, your authority. Where does the authority, overcoming power, the ability come from to stand against all that is in the world? The forces of hell that are fighting against God, His redemption and His salvation, comes from one place and one place only. Not from your human ability, not from your discipline, not from all that you know, but from the reality of Christ in you. Your confidence of glory, the greater one, living on the inside of you. And in Jesus' name, there's nobody walking out of this place without that revelation, without that persuasion, without that is the faith. Amen. Believe me, that is fundamentally the faith. Encapsulated into a sentence, God has come to live and dwell on the inside of you. Emmanuel. God is in me. More than lives with me, He is in me.